الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيد المرسلين وخاتم النبيين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ومن سار على نهجه إلى يوم الدين. My dear respected brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We'll resume inshallah our class by the will of Allah عز وجل. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase us in the knowledge of the deen. And may Allah Azza wa Jalla give us sincerity to make this session and this act, inshallah, as an act of ibadah for him that may be blessed and get rewarded by him, Azza wa Jalla. طيب, we already, as we mentioned before, we still discussing some of the narrations, some of the ahadith of the book of Bulugh al-Maram, which discuss different types of forbidden sale or forbidden commercial transactions, which is mean it's not lawful. And we mentioned some of them in previous weeks. And inshallah today we'll continue with this hadith narrated by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma. Tawus, as you see it here in the screen, the hadith, Tawus narrated on the authority of Ibn Abbas that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, do not go out to meet caravans on the way, make deal with them. That means their caravan, some traders come, you know, coming to the city or the town from other place, from outside the city. Don't go and meet them outside. And no townsman is permitted to sell things on behalf of man from the desert. Now, I mentioned the desert, but in fact, to be representative to sell some products for somebody from outside. This is the point here. I asked Abdullah, I asked Ibn Abbas, this is Tawus said, what did he mean by saying no towns is permitted to sell on behalf of a Bedouin, somebody from coming from the desert or outside? He replied, he should not be broker for him. This hadith is agreed upon. Now let's go to the explanation of this hadith and the hadith. This mentioned sometime for transaction or a way of trading which is not lawful, which is forbidden. And then we'll understand why it is forbidden. One of them, as it said, talaqqi al-rukban. Talaqqi al-rukban, you see that some, for example, villages, some people in farms outside the city or outside the town, they bring their products. For example, their dates, vegetables, fruits, or milk from their cattle to sell it inside the town. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it's not lawful for someone from the town to go out before they reach the market and try to make deal with them. Why? Because here we are thinking about the interest of the group, interest of the community. And this action, in fact, it serves the interest of whom? Of individuals, of individuals. So the reason why, because when they go, these people, or traders outside, they may buy it from those villagers or those, you know, traders who are coming from outside. They may buy it in very cheap price. Why? Because those who brought their products to sell it in the town, they don't know or they don't have any background about the prices or the value of their products inside the town. So they take it very cheap. And then the other side, when they bring it, to the town because they are the only people who are hold it or own it, then they will sell it with a higher price because there's no competition. They already took whatever come from outside in their hands. So when they come to the city, the town, they can put the price they want. So this is why it's not lawful. So the Prophet ﷺ wants those people who come from outside to come to the town, and then people of the town, they can see it, and there will be competency, and there's a lot of product available for people to choose from, not for some or certain few individuals to go out and take this, commercial products, and then they have control on the market. So this is the point from this. Right. The other point also, which is mentioned in this hadith, also the broker, the broker, he will come to this Bedouin or whoever come from outside, and he said, you don't know the prices in the town, so I will sell it for you. And then when he bring it also may raise the price now for this. طيب. The next hadith, Abu Hurairah narrated that the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, do not go out to meet what is being brought for the market by riders, al-rukban, from outside. If one of the trader is met and some of his goods are sold, then when the owner arrives at the market, he has the choice whether to cancel the deal or accept it. Now the Prophet ﷺ, he left a chance for this trader who was outside, who sold it for somebody who come from the town. And then he already sold it. But when he arrived to the city or the town, he found that the price that was given to him was very cheap. It's not something that he expected. The price is very high here. And this guy who came and met him in the middle of the way took it in cheap price. He said, fil khiyar, that means the seller has the option to cancel the deal. To cancel the deal. Why? Because he was deceived. He didn't expect this to be the price that he want to get. Now, so, and the next to this, Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu said, the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, prohibited that a city dweller, that's mean a person who is living in the city or residence of the city, sells on behalf of man from the desert, from outside the town. Doesn't matter, is it city, desert or village. And order not to bid against one another. No man should outbid the selling of his brother, that's my Muslim brother, nor propose to marry a woman whom his brother has proposed to. And no woman should ask for a divorce of her sister in Islam to take advantage of what is in her pot. That's mean here there are different matters which are related. Maybe you're surprised. What's the relation between buying, selling, and getting married, and divorce, and all these different issues? Maybe it looks strange that all of them, they come in one hadith. But there are one thing which is in common. What is it? That there are competition in the wrong way. Competition between people in a forbidden way, which means that a person or the individual here, he is caring about his own interest, even he harmed his brother or sister, either in trade, in trading and selling and buying, or when, you know, to get married or to divorce or whatever. And this, my dear brothers, this is why, my dear brothers and sisters, what purpose here when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade or made all these types of action are forbidden? As you know, always we mention this many times, and we emphasize that Islam is care about the unity of the Muslim, the real meaning of brotherhood among the believers. Therefore, they should deal with each other as brothers and sisters and care about each other and never get advantage on, you know, in a way that will harm or take the rights of others. And this is why, as you may notice, that most of these types of transaction will create enmity, will create dispute among the Muslims. And here, let's go on this one by one. He said, prohibited seller sells on behalf of a man from the desert. Why? As we mentioned here, because he will have control over the prices. He may deceive the person who come from outside, and he will not get a good price for his products. He may, you know, make it so he want to make profit because he will take some percentage. He will make the price so high, so the people will not be able to offer. Only those, you know, a few people, they can get it. So subhanAllah, this is to show you how Islam cares about the stability, even in the economics and economic side, in the country or in the town. Because economic is very important for the life, the people. People are, you know, depend on each other. They buy, they sell, you know, they get service, they paid for the services. All this exchange of manafa, exchange of benefits among people. So it should be run in a way that will not create bad competition, negative competition that will lead to enmity or lead to dispute among the Muslim. And, you know, then the community, there will be a lot of differences or groups or lobbies and all these matters. But the next one, as you may notice, it said here, no man should outbid the selling of his brother. Now, does this mean bidding is forbidden? No. Be careful. Bidding is okay. What does it mean, bidding? That means someone said this car, he brought his car, and someone told him, I buy it for 5,000 riyal. And then somebody add 100, and another one had more. And then the process here, and the seller did not decide. He's still waiting to see how much his car will get for him as price. It's okay. But what does it mean here to bid over your brother? But when the deal is settled, see, that's mean the seller said, okay, after they bidding for some time, and then he said, okay, I will sell it for this person for 6,000 riyal. Now the seller has already made his mind. At this point, nobody has the right to come after this, you know, the conclusion of this argument or this, you know, bargaining, to say, oh, no, wait. I can give you 6,500. This is forbidden. Why it is forbidden? Because it's already, the deal is settled. The deal is settled. And the buyer, the seller, he agreed to sell it to this person in 6,000. if you came before and you make bargain or bidding with others, and before this seller decide to stop the bidding and make his mind to sell it, then it's okay. But after the settlement of the bargaining between all these sides, and the seller or the owner of this product accepted the deal that he will sell it at this price for someone, then it's over. So this is forbidden to come, to sell it or to pay more money. Or on the other side, maybe someone else, he will say and say to this one who already want to buy it with 6,000, said, no, wait. I have a car that I better than this, and I can sell it to you and better price. Also, this is forbidden. Why? Because as we said, this will create enmity and dispute among Muslims. And then it said, nor propose to marry a woman whom his brother has proposed to. What does it mean? There is a woman that a man, he want to marry her. Let's say, for example, a man, he asked for the marriage or made proposal to a marriage of certain lady. And then the family of the lady, they already agree after their time of thinking, discussing, making istikhara and everything. And they said, okay, we accepted your proposal. Then it's not right for someone else to come and say, also, I have a proposal to marry her. This is not right. How about if he doesn't know? He doesn't know that they already gave him, they already made their mind and they gave him. Then he have no harm, but they should tell him. They should tell him. Besides, if the family did not decide yet, a man asked or made proposal for certain lady to marry her. And then another man want to marry this woman also, but the family did not decide it. They didn't give him, the first person, any promise that they agree. They said, we still think about it. It's okay. That proposal come from here and from here and from there, no problem. But the minute that the family decided to accept the proposal of one person, this will close the issue. So no one should come and said, after they already promised that person of accepting his proposal, come and say, no, wait. I also have a proposal to marry her. That's not right. As we said, because this will create troubles between people. And no woman should ask for the divorce of her sister. A man want to marry a second woman, for example, a second wife, and it is lawful for him. And when he made the proposal, this lady, she said, okay, I will accept your proposal, but in one condition, that you divorce your wife. This is haram. This is haram and not lawful. And the man cannot accept it as condition because this is forbidden. Why? Because this lady, the second woman, is thinking only about her own interest. I want to destroy the life of her sister in Islam, also, which is not lawful, which is forbidden. As you know, my brothers and sisters, you see, Islam care, about the community, about the spirit of brotherhood, and unity in the Muslim, village or town or community. So anything may create any dispute, all are blocked, either in business or in social affair or anything else. is to show you subhanAllah, the wisdom and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right. And then to take his pot, as you know, to replace her as a wife, this hadith is agreed upon. Right. Let's go to the next hadith. Let me see if there any thing here. Nah. Here, just I would like to mention something. Maybe some people they ask about this. Okay, how about if a woman, for example, when her, a man proposed to marry her, she said, "Okay, I accept your proposal, but with one condition." Okay, what's the condition? That if you marry me, or if I accept your proposal, and then we get married, you don't marry another woman. Don't marry another woman. Is this correct or not? Is this condition is okay or not? Yes, it is. Yes, it is. It's okay. So the lady, before she get married, for example, she put this condition in the marriage contract. One of the marriage contracts, that in case that you marry another woman, then I have the right to divorce myself. So if he agree on this condition, then it will be part of the contract of the marriage. This is okay. Why? Because here she didn't, you know, affect anybody else from the beginning. From the beginning, all what she asked for is to have the freedom to get divorced or to be separated from this man in case that he marry another woman. Now. Right. So the man, he should respect this type of condition. That means he doesn't say okay and then accept it, and then afterward he will go and marry another woman, and then he said, whatever, that's up to you. If you want to stay or you leave, that's not right. Why? Because when you agree on this, that means you already gave them hope, or give this lady hope, that not marry other lady. Therefore, you should respect this condition. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us to fulfill this condition. طيب. So in conclusion, as Sheikh bin Thamin said, in conclusion in this, he said, the Muslim then, he should respect the rights of other, of his brothers and sisters in every matter, especially when you are talking about exchange benefits, either in the area of trade and business, or in social affairs like, you know, matter like marriage, contract of marriage, or any deal. The Muslim should be very careful not to have a deal to benefit himself. At the same time, he hurt other Muslim. And as it, this is the same, my dear brothers, sometimes, and even in the area of job, occupation. If you know that your brother in Islam, he was accepted by a company to be assigned to work at that company, and they want to sign the contract with him already, they agree. You don't have the right to go and present yourself to take his position, push him away and get this contract, as long as they gave him the effort. But if there's competition, they are open the door, the gate, you know, for anyone who want to submit his application. No problem. Everybody will submit his application to get this job. But the minute that this company, this business, they decide that this job will be given to so-and-so, then everybody should stop, should not compete and go afterward and say, I can take it, I have better skills, I have all this is also haram. This hadith, in fact, it's not applicable now. This talk about dealing and selling and buying for slavery at that time. So in very short, it said, if anyone separate mother and her child, Allah will separate him from his beloved ones on the day of resurrection. You know, before, because there is slavery, so there are sometimes what they do, they sell the mother so to one person and the child to another person, and this separate them, so they didn't leave the family. So Islam forbid this. And as we mentioned, when we talk about slavery in Islam, that Islam did not encourage slavery, but this issue in very wise way, and therefore I will not go to discuss more about. Yeah, let's talk about this one. This Anas bin Malik. Anas bin Malik, radiallahu anhu, said the prices went up in Medina during the time with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So the people, they came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and asked him and said, Prophet of Allah, O Messenger of Allah, the price went up, so please fix the prices. That's mean put fixed price, certain price. So please fix the price for us. Now look at the answer of the Messenger of Allah. You see, Islam, you know, far before this time, you know, put the rules for the successful trading and business and, you know, development and progress in the area of business. Nowadays, they say this is the capital or the communism. We have two sides, and the Islam in the middle. The Islam protects the rights of everyone. He encouraged competition, but at the same time, doesn't encourage or stop any harm that may harm the community. So he, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said, what? Allah is the one who fixes the prices. He is the restrainer. He is the one who gives generosity and supply sustainer. And I wish to meet Allah, the Almighty, with none of you having any claim on me for any injustice regarding blood, profit, or property, as will be. Right. So this was related by the five compiler of the hadith. What does this mean? This mean, you see, this is what we call it now. It's free market. That's mean people can compete and giving or producing products on trades and giving services, compete. Because if you fix the price in certain level, there may be some people or the economy will not grow. So there should be a time of competition. And you know the market, that whenever there are a lot of products available, then the prices will go low, down. And whenever there, you know, just a little, not enough, and there is a lot or high demand for certain product, then the price will go up. So what the wisdom here? So when the price go up, there are many producers will think about this market and they will think, wow, this is great chance to make money. So they will enter and invest in this area, and then they will get more production and more products of the same. And this is what we see it now. You see, for example, now, if you talk about milk, about any types of food or of services, you have many companies. They give this type of services. So like here, for example, for if the country, in one country or one village, there is only one supplier or one provider of the service of the mobile service, for example, telephone services. There is one, what will happen? Then he will control the market to the price that he wants. But when other investors or companies, they see, wow, that this in this area or this country, in this town, there high demand for this service, they will enter the market. And then the competition starts between those traders and the price will go down. So this is the wisdom the Prophet ﷺ didn't like to put this, fixed price. So it's not right to put fixed price according to this hadith. But this will not understand it till we see the next one, because they complete each of these two hadith, they complete each other. طيب. The hadith is said that Mu'ammar ibn Abdullah, أو معامر بن عبد الله رضي الله عنه narrated that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, no one monopolize except that he is a sinner. Monopolize, what does it mean here? Monopolize, that's mean the person who have control on certain product and he forced the people and the people are in need for this product, and then he put high price for it. And you know that the people, they have no choice. There's no other company will provide the same service or will provide the same product. Therefore, he put high price and he is relaxed that he know that people will get back to him. Or in that way, for example, he will hold the product in his store or in his storage. He will not get it out for the market. Wait till it's almost and disappear from the market. And then people start to look for it for any price. And when he feels that people are in need and there's high demand and people are willing to pay more money, then he will get it out of his story. This is called ihtikar. This is also haram. This is haram and not lawf. So the ruler or the government should not interfere in this. Should leave it for the market to go up and down. And this is what they call it, the free capital, in certain situation. But at the same time, it's not right to take advantage of the need of the people. So the issues here, the first one is if the price was up because of the limited quantity of this product, then there's no way to put a price for it because it's already very few and people are in need for it. And as we mentioned that, when it was left without fixed price, then other provider will enter the market and this will increase the competition in the market. And this is why it's not right to make this decision regarding this now. But in case that there is, traders or group of businessmen, they have an agreement among them and they decided to put high price, what in fact it's not equal to the product or the service they provide. And among them, they decide no one of them will sell less than this price. And then the profit was very high. Let's say, for example, if it was cost only 10 riyals, and then he sell it with the 25 or 30, that double the price, he will get profit. Then the government or the ruler or, you know, the authority, they have the right to interfere to protect the right of the community and the people from those group of traders who they want to take advantage of the need of the people, and they put, you know, unreasonable price or very high price. So this is, for example, with them, you know, how come you buy this product for 10 riyals and you sell it for 50 riyals, 40 riyals, more than four times you get profit? Then it is the right for the government to interfere and put. And this is what happened, you know, here, alhamdulillah, in this country, because alhamdulillah, they apply the Sharia. And many times the government doesn't interfere and put in price for, but when the price go up, in a way that it's not reasonable, then they will come and they put certain line for these prices to have control and to make sure that those, especially low economy, you know, those people with low income, they will not suffer in the community. طيب, it's already, I think it's almost 8. Now we have 7 minutes. And you know, the Isha now, it's almost 7:59. So we have about 6 minutes for the Adhan. So we'll leave this, inshallah. I will continue, inshallah, next week. So if you have any question regarding this or others, please go ahead and ask. Barakallahu feekum. Nah. Yes, Noor, go ahead. Mute your mic and you can ask your question. Yes. Go ahead now.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I just want to ask regarding the business or business about franchising. Then suddenly, yes, you will know it was networking. What is the stand in Islam regarding the networking business?
Well, network business, in fact, some ulama, they didn't approve it. They didn't approve it. If I understood your question, there are some people who try to make it, you know, to get more customers for the same company or the product, and then they get a certain percentage. This is some ulama, they didn't approve this kind of business. So they said it is not lawful. Nah.
Then if ever, in my situation, I was attending a seminar first. Then someone told me that, are you interested? Because at first I was told it was only a franchising business. And then I said, yes, I was interested. So they encode my name. And then she said, okay, I will give the money first, because it's involved the money for franchising. So suddenly, the day after tomorrow, I attend for another meeting, and I just found out that it was a networking. So I told her that I don't want to continue because it's haram.
Yes.
Should I pay for that amount, or I don't have any obligation to pay for it?
No. Did they give you money, or you didn't get anything from them?
I didn't get anything, but they said I need to pay for them because my name is already encoded. So
tell them they just remove it, and then they don't have to pay them anything.
Okay, jazakallah khairan.
Yeah. Right. Other questions? Yes.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh, ya Sheikh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Naam.
I just want to ask if this kind of business is a little bit what do you call this overpriced in its original price. Okay. In my place in Bicol, we buy and sell seafoods. Okay, we understand that the seafoods is much higher priced. So we buy and sell directly from the sea, and then we bring to the city. For example, we buy that for 180 pesos. And then when we bring to the city, it will cost 300 to 400 pesos. The reason why it is higher price, it's because we pay for the transportation from the island to the city that costs, example is 200 pesos. To go and then 200 pesos back. So yeah, do you think it is a high price? No problem with
that. Okay. No problem with this, inshallah, because you want to make a profit. And as we said, this depends on the product. See, this people who are keeping the need mainly for something that people are, you know, need, like, you know, food, something like this. And some people, they cannot afford. But since you are, you know, buy it with a certain price, and then also you spend services and transportation and maybe keeping it in storage and all this are considered as expenses for the product that you brought. So there's no problem if you sell it in, you know, in this price or more. It depends on the market. As long as it's available everywhere, no problem.
Alhamdulillah. Okay, can I ask again one more question?
Okay.
In my village in Philippines, we have a transportation called Pajak. It's a bicycle. Okay.
Yes.
And so, if you own a bicycle, you can ask that for rent for the other people to work for you. The rent for one bicycle to use for one day, they will pay you boundary called, we called it boundary, maybe 50 pesos like that. Okay. So there's one man come into me. He wants to sell the bicycle to me. He wants to sell the bicycle to me for his price. Okay. And then I buy the bicycle, for example, 10,000 pesos. Okay. And then he asked a favor to me to say that, can I use this bicycle to pay you for installment? And for my condition is, of course, I will say to her, you will pay it two times, the boundary and the payment for the installment. The agreement is okay, or I am bad, or what?
Did you set a certain time or limit that he can use this bike? Or it's open? Is it open till he collect the money? Or is it, he said, in 6 months, for example, or 2 months?
I don't know to the other people if they, but for me, as long as you pay the 10,000.
I'm asking you about your agreement with this person, okay? Because this we already mentioned before. It's okay. It's okay to have condition for using anything that you sell, but in one condition, which is that condition should be clear and not ambiguous. As we said, for example, you sell your car to someone, and then you tell them, okay, I sold it to you for 10,000 riyal, but I will use it for two months, okay, and then I can hand it to you. That's okay. But to say, for example, okay, I will use it till I find another car that I like, then this is not correct. Why? Because you don't know when he will find this car. The same thing for this, the example that you mentioned. If this person, he said a certain time, he said, okay, if you just let me or give me a chance to use this bike for 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, okay, and then I'll pay you every day. This is different, okay? Anyway, inshallah, I'll try to study this case in deep, and then I'll give you full answer next week, inshallah, to make sure that you get the right answer. Okay, this is last question for Juan. Now, welcome. Juan, go ahead, please. Unmute you. Go ahead.
Okay. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum assalam.
I just remembered last year my husband died. So his
insurance.
Yeah, but I wasn't an Islam, so I didn't know. So my mother-in-law used the money for business, but the business is it's a piggery. So what can I do if my mother-in-law pay me back? So what can I do with that? Because she used the money for piggery, you know, pork is haram. So I didn't know that before. So, yeah.
Since you are ignorant about this or this because before you become Muslim, inshallah, you are not responsible for it. Because whatever is before becoming Muslim, it's forgiven from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have the right, you know, but the other point is this husband, I mean, at that time, you were in the same religion, right?
Yes, if she pay me back with the money she borrowed, because it was my husband's insurance, so it's my name with my children. So she just borrowed it because I'm here working.
Yeah, no problem. As long as it is originally yours and it was returned back to you, no problem with this.
Okay. I feel so bad because.
Will you send your question in detail to that to the admin of our meeting, inshallah? Will you send it please in detail, and maybe, and then we can study it, and you know, to know the all the detail regarding your question. This will be better, inshallah.
Shukran.
I think there's one question. Is it allowed a divorce in Muslim according to the hadith? This is it was in the chat here. Is it allowed to divorce in a Muslim? Yes. I mean, what do you mean by you mean that a man that he can divorce his wife? It is permissible. Yeah, divorce, no problem with this, but there is certain procedure to follow. It's not the first option, the first choice, but it's not forbidden in Islam. You know, if a woman and man, they cannot live together, not to separate it through the correct way, which is divorce. I hope that I understood the question correctly. Do you mean that the woman want to divorce herself from husband? This is another matter. This is called khul, which is different. So in Islam, there is right for the man, and also at the same time, there is right for the woman to ask for separation and end the contract of marriage under certain conditions, certain circumstances. It's not open like this. For example, if the woman, she has legitimate reason, real reason, cause to request for divorce, this is called khul. And she can arrange for this, and there is certain procedure for this. For the man, it's more, you know, just if he, because he is the one who asked for this contract, then he can easily, if he have dispute with his wife and the family, they try to make some reconciliation between them, and all attempt to rebuild the relation between them failed, and it was the last option, then it's okay also to divorce. I hope this answered your question. Okay, jazakumullah khair, brothers and sisters. We already, alhamdulillah, that we reach the end of our class, and we'll see you inshallah next week at 7:15 as usual. Maybe in the future we'll make the class more earlier if it is suitable for most of you. طيب, see you next week. جزاكم الله خير. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us all in the knowledge of the deen, of the deen, and bless our knowledge, and make this knowledge increase our iman, to increase our tranquility, get us more near to our Lord to please him, and it will be in our good deeds at the day of judgment. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam.